गाइस वी आर बैक इन अनदर सेशन विद एमी एंड जस्ट टू गिव अ बैकग्राउंड अबाउट व्हाट शी डज लाइक वी डिड यस्टरडे। सो एमी इज अ ट्रेवल ब्लॉगर एंड हर वर्क हैज बीन पब्लिश्ड इन फ्यू मेजर पब्लिकेशंस, इनफैक्ट लॉट ऑफ मेजर पब्लिकेशंस। यस्टरडे वी स्पोक टू हर अबाउट हर ट्रेवल एक्सपीरियंस, हाउ द जर्नी स्टार्टेड, few things about what she's doing now, what she has done before she started with her travel blogging career. Today, it's a very important topic that we want to cover with her. That's travel blogging. Tips and tricks of travel blogging, how to start, step by step, जिनको भी अपना करियर ट्रेवल ब्लॉगिंग में बनाना है वो कहाँ से शुरू करें, कैसे शुरू करें। सो एमी, हम लोग देखते हैं काफी सारे ऐसे लोग हैं जो जो ट्रेवल ब्लॉगिंग के बारे में पता करना चाहते हैं, जानना चाहते हैं, लेकिन देर इज नो क्लियर कट डायरेक्शन एज टू वेयर टू स्टार्ट फ्रॉम, व्हाट शुड बी द फर्स्ट स्टेप। एंड आई विल गो अ लिटिल लिटिल बैकवर्ड इन दिस केस, अ स्टेप बिहाइंड, एंड व्हाट शुड बी द पैरामीटर टू डिसाइड वेदर यू शुड स्टार्ट विद ट्रेवल ब्लॉगिंग पर से, इज इट रियली फॉर यू, एंड देन टेक अ प्लंज, व्हाट शुड बी दैट थिंग।
ओके सो अगर आप बोल रहे हो कि ट्रैवल ब्लॉगिंग इज व्हाट यू आर इंटरेस्टेड इन, यू नीड टू क्वेश्चन योरसेल्फ एंड फाइंड आउट व्हाई ट्रैवल ब्लॉगिंग। इज इट बिकॉज यू लाइक ट्रैवल और इज इट बिकॉज यू लाइक सम बिट ऑफ द ग्लैमर दैट कम्स विद इट, और इज इट दैट यू नो यू हैव बीन टू अ लॉट ऑफ प्लेसेस एंड यू हैव दिस अर्ज टू कीप गोइंग एंड शेयरिंग what you have done. So there are a lot of questions you need to ask because travel blogging is not as easy as it seems. The only way to sustain through the entire travel blogging and make it lucrative for yourself is if you have the passion for it. Because it's only that passion which will keep you going through the ups and downs of it. एंड सक्सेस डजंट कम दैट इजिली। कल भी मैंने यही बोला था कि सक्सेस टेक्स अ लॉट ऑफ टाइम टू कम थ्रू। योर फर्स्ट ब्रेक माइट टेक अ रियली लॉन्ग टाइम फॉर यू टू कम थ्रू, सो यू नीड टू बी लिटल माइंडफुल अबाउट दैट। द सेकेंड थिंग दैट आई विल से इज वॉट इज अ काइंड ऑफ कॉन्टेंट यू वॉन्ट पुट आउट। आर यू ट्राइंग टू जस्ट पुट आउट कॉन्टेंट विच एवरीबडी हैज, और आर यू you know you've been to xyz places and you know so much about it that you know you really can help someone, right? So if you're going to put up regular content, there's plenty of websites which are there, you don't really need to add. But if you're going to tell them specifically about your experience and the you know chote chote tips wagaira, ya fir you've had some really unique experiences in the same place, I mean it could be simple places like Jaipur which is so well covered and stuff. So do you have those kind of experiences which you know which bring out a different flavor of the place, or which bring out certain important aspects of the place which you think are very important for the travelers to know? So wo jo andar ke tips they say na, that you know those kind of tips, are you able to bring that to the table? So that's one distinguishing feature. So there are various ways in which you can do a travel blog. It could be like a you know you are sharing a first person experience, it could be something like you're sharing travel tips as well. So there are different voices to travel blogging also that you need to figure out. So yeah, so basically where do you slot yourself, where do you see yourself in these kind of situations? What is it that people want to read, and can you meet that thing consistently and you know consistently, and are you going to be able to do it also in future? So a lot of times what happens is, especially when you are in a job, and that's what happened with me, you do not get that many leaves, or you may not be able to get content that easily, or you may not be able to take up a lot of trips and stuff, because I do know of a lot of travel blogging friends who are full time into work, and I do see that constraint. So having said that, you know, you need to keep those constraints in mind, because travel blogging does require you to get out of the house, right? Or get out of your, let's say, and get your leaves and stuff. So if you're doing this part-time, be cognizant of the fact that you will never be able to do as much as a full-time traveler. There will be constraints. I I know of a lot of my friends, and for who've been chosen for very, very prestigious trips, but they had to let go of it because they do not have the leaves for it. So there are constraints. There are those kind of constraints also that you need to keep in mind when you are thinking of travel blogging, because the requirement for content is very consistent. So
Absolutely.
only when you have constant content will you be able to fulfill that particular niche. Will your website get updated very frequently? You will not lose audience. You will have a constant audience coming in and newer audience coming in. So to build all that, you definitely need to have a pool of content, and you should be able to get that pool of content as
So what should be the first step? I mean, how to start with the blogging thing?
well. So I'm assuming that the people who want to start with travel blogging already are sitting on content. या तो वो लोग ऑलरेडी ट्रैवलर्स है जिसके पास बहुत सारा कंटेंट है, या दे आर विलिंग टू गो अहेड एंड गो अराउंड एंड गेट द ट्राई दिस थिंग. सो दैट्स अ गिवन. नाउ अज्यूमिंग दैट्स अ गिवन, द नेक्स्ट स्टेप इज एक्चुअली स्टार्टिंग टू डॉक्यूमेंट इट. सो देर आर वेरियस वेज टू डॉक्यूमेंट इट. देर आर पीपल हु डू फोटो ब्लॉग्स. सो आप सिर्फ फोटोग्राफ लेके डॉक्यूमेंट कर सकते हो. यू कैन जस्ट डू फोटो ब्लॉग्स, और यू टिपिकली मोस्ट ट्रैवल ब्लॉग्स हैव अ लॉट ऑफ रिटन कंटेंट बिकॉज नॉट एवरीथिंग कैन बी सेड बाय अ फोटो. So when you have written content, in either of the cases, you need to have a particular what do you call domain or a blog in your name. So typically, a lot of people start with something like a WordPress.com or Blogger.com because that's the easiest thing to do. And frankly speaking, I think the first two, three posts, or maybe even up to five, six posts, are great on these WordPress.com and Blogger.com because you will know whether you really like writing, or you don't like writing, or you like that particular format, or you don't like a particular, or do you want to kind of get into videos, in which case these two are not your platforms, then you're talking about completely different, which is YouTube vlogging. So are you looking at videos? So these platforms are free platforms, blogspot.com and wordpress.com, and it's a great way to start and figure out whether you really want to do the writing bit of your travel, right? So one is experience, because everybody's passionate about experience, but not everybody has it in them to want to sit and write. And when you start writing, you realize how much of details goes in, what kind of content you need to actually collect. Do you really have those things which close those gaps which people are looking at? Are you able to answer the questions? So these are things which will come along when you start writing down. So the first step I would say is create your blog on one of these platforms, which is either WordPress.com or Blogspot.com. The second step would be actually give it a name. Now, a lot of people give it their own name, which is also perfectly fine. Yeah, for you give something which is more related to what you're going to kind of do. So maybe something like, in my case, it's thrillingtravel.in. So it's in somebody else's case, it could be wanderer something, wanderlust.com or something of that sort. I mean, something which gives you a flavor, which tells people what you're going to be talking about, and which is easy for people to remember. So one of the biggest things which I tell people is do not try to go overboard with your vocabulary. Keep it simple, because if people cannot spell your blog, they will not come to your blog. You've lost a lot of people there. And I have seen this. I have seen this over and over again. A lot of us have made that mistake. We go a little overboard and we give this very sophisticated name which people are not able to remember. Okay. So yeah, the spelling mein garba kar lete hain, ya fir this thing, because for your blog to actually start ranking in Google, it will take some time. Right? So don't expect. So till then, you are left to people's memories and people's spelling and vocabulary and everything. So if you have something which is very sorry.
I'll tell you my case in this. So my blog name is outtoroam.com. So this Rome and ROME, mine is ROAM, and ROAME
Okay.
means बहुत कंफ्यूजन होता है. तो इनफैक्ट व्हेन एवर आई टेल समवन कि माय इंस्टा हैंडल और माय ट्विटर हैंडल या ब्लॉग का, आई हैव टू स्पेल इट डाउन कि भाई ROME वाला नहीं, ROAM वाला है. सो दैट्स वन मिस्टेक
But it's not still, it is still a very small this thing, it's very small percentage if you ask me. But there are people who go into things लाइक सिंसिलेटिंग समथिंग. नाउ सिंसिलेटिंग का स्पेलिंग किसी को याद नहीं रहता है अनफॉर्चुनेटली. सो यू नो कीप इट सिंपल इज माय बिगेस्ट एडवाइस. सो फर्स्ट यू गेट इट टू ब्लॉगस्पॉट, फिगर आउट द नेम, कीप इट सिंपल. एंड व्हेन यू आर टेकिंग योर नेम इनिशियली इट विल बी व्हाटएवर, लेट्स से फॉर xyz .wordpress.com. But after four five blogs or after five after 10 blogs, you've figured out this is really what you want to do. Invest into getting that name for yourself, right? Own that name, which means basically you get into a domain name. You buy the domain name, right? So in my case, by the time I decided, it was thrillingtravel.com was not available. So then I had to go with thrillingtravel.in. You know, those are and probably nobody told me at that point in time saying तुम्हारे 10 ब्लॉग तो इतने अच्छे हो गए और ले यू नो टेक द नेम. नोबडी टोल्ड मी दैट. सो आई टुक द नेम अ लिटिल लेटर, व्हिच वाज व्हाई आई प्रॉबली डिड नॉट गेट .com. बट इफ यू आर एबल टू गेट योर .coms इन प्लेस, देयर इज नथिंग लाइक इट. एंड इट्स अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग इन योर ब्लॉगिंग स्टेप इटसेल्फ. सो दैट इज द सेकेंड थिंग. सो यू गेट द नेम एंड यू ओन द नेम. द थर्ड एंड द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग अगेन व्हिच आई डिड as a big mistake was, I did not go in for a host immediately. So I waited for a while and then I bought a hosting space. Now, hosting space are pretty cheap. It's not very, you know, you get for a beginner blog, you get amazing hosting plans, which are like about 10,000 Indian rupees for 3 years. So for people who have initially started doing, it's 10,000 rupees for 3 years is not a big deal. It is worth the investment because that space in the web server is what you own. Tomorrow, WordPress can close down, Blogspot can close down. Google can say, I don't want Blogspot anymore. You will lose your entire work. But if you have that space, the likelihood of you losing that space is very minimal. So it's very important to start owning the space. So after you get your name, get the space. And typically these are bundle deals which are available. Most companies offer you a hosting plan and the hosting name together. So take advantage of it and take it and get into, you know, you own the space, right? So now you have a space, you have the place to write, you have this thing. So you've actually started your blogging, you've started your blogging bit. This is where I insist when after some 10, 15 blogs, you know that things are going well for you, you really want to continue, then invest into SEO. Now, again, this is something that most of us as hobby bloggers, we all started very late. I still have a lot of posts which are there on my website, which are not SEO optimized because I used to just write. But now I'm beginning to realize that I should have done that earlier.
So it would be great if you can elaborate a bit about what exactly SEO is, search engine optimization karta kya hai, and why is that so important in your blog?
Yeah. So, aapne blog likh to liya, you've written a blog post. How do you bring it out to people? See, initially your circle of friends will be just limited, right? 50 friends, 100 friends, that's it. But how do you bring it to the world? Because Google takes a long time for indexing, right? Now, initial traction comes from social media, typically. So most of us write, publish, and then share the link on social media. That's where your initial traffic comes, and that's when your beginning of ranking starts, right? So Google sees that this particular domain is getting a little popular. So it starts indexing. Now, when it starts indexing on something called as keywords, right? So if somebody is searching for, let's say, things to do in Jaipur, it will start pulling out blogs which have a lot of information on Jaipur. So when you actually Google this, you'll realize the search goes on to over 100 pages, 200 pages, whatever, right? Because you are all competing for that things to do in Jaipur. So how do you make sure that you are in the top 10? That is where search engine optimization actually comes in. Because when you are in the top 10, and I'm not talking about top 10 pages, I'm talking about the top 10
the first search page, basically.
First page and top 10 search results. If that is, if only if you are there, you are likely to get the Google traffic. And if you get the Google traffic, if you get the chunk of Google traffic which is coming to you, you are getting consistent traffic on your blog through the year. Right? So that is why search engine optimization is extremely important, because you need to get that share of the pie. And for that, you need to understand how the indexing works, or how the keywords work, how you need to include the keywords into your content, how do you look for the right keywords. There are a lot of
Right.
aspects to the search engine optimization. So that is the content part of search engine optimization. There is also a technical part of search engine optimization, which is basically that when you have a blog, you have a site map. Site map basically tells you what is categorized where in simple
Right.
words. So this site map, you need to submit it to Google, otherwise Google won't know. So you need to submit it to Google. You need to connect your Google to analytics. You need to connect to a lot of things in the back end, right? So that is a technical SEO part of it. How long does your website take to load? Is there any error in your website crawling? I mean, these are things which come in the technical SEO part of it. So yes,
So
sure, you can always
in
hire a
this
guy
technical
to.
part, yeah. So in this technical part, I mean, so as far as basic SEO optimization is concerned, we can actually do a bit from our side. As a writer, we can kind of take care of it. But this technical
Yes.
part, what do you suggest? How should one go about it? But because
So,
indexing a
yeah.
site, yeah, you got.
So investing into the site and all is pretty much something that everybody can do on their own. And when I say technical, so there are aspects of technical optimization which you should be able to do on your own, like submitting the site map, connecting the analytics, connecting the Google search consoles. These are very, very simple tasks which can be done on your own. Getting a theme. Now, themes are very important. What kind of a theme is your website running on? Is your theme itself search engine friendly, right? Because those are things which we need to read up on. So even if you're hiring somebody else to do the theme for you need to understand what that person is doing, because ultimately, when you get down to actually the blogging business, you need to know what that guy is talking and what are the errors which are coming up and what you need to tweak accordingly. So
Right.
basic knowledge is very important. You may not do it, you may not get your hands dirty by actually doing it, but it is very important to understand that you have ticked those boxes. And what those boxes are is where you need to read up a lot and figure out the SEO part of it, the technical SEO part of it.
So for the basic SEO, how should we go about it? I mean, when we optimize our content from SEO point of view, what should be the approach? Does it start from writing the content itself? I mean, let's say I want to write something about Manali, my experience about Manali. So should I keep in mind the SEO related stuff while starting the blog, or should I start optimizing it once I have the content, and then how should I go about it?
There are two schools of thought. There are people who write for SEO, so they tailor the content around the SEO keywords that they have found, which also works very well. And then there are people who want to write something and then figure out the SEO part of it in between. So I typically do the second one, which is basically I know what I want to write and therefore I figure out the SEO. But there are times where I've also written for SEO. So the whole search engine content part of it is pretty, frankly speaking, takes a lot of time. You need to find the right keywords. You need to do a keyword research, right? So that involves a fair bit of brainstorming. Then it also involves you using tools. There are a lot of free tools. There are a lot of paid tools. So initially, you may start with the free tools which are available, like Google Suggest and Uber Suggest, and then you may go on to paid tools like keyword research, keyword planning tools, Moz. So there are a lot of tools which actually go into that. So you find the word, you figure out how much how much of volume it has. Then you kind of do a benefit analysis, saying how is the competition versus the volume? Can you score better? There are a lot of
Right.
factors which go into that, which you need to obviously get into, saying what is your DA? Is your DA going to be able to score against this particular website which is in the top 10? So there's a lot of this thing which goes into finding those keywords. once you found the keywords, then you get them into the content. So even in the content, there are certain rules. Like for example, you need to use the keywords in the headings x number of times. You
Right.
need to have them in the first 100 to 200 words,
Right.
maybe 2 or 3 times. Then there are things like, for example, how do you name your pictures? You can't just name them as IMG underscore something, which is what most of us have done.
Yeah, I also do that.
Most of
Yeah.
us have done. But there is a way to name pictures as well, and how do you use your keywords in the alt attributes of the picture. So you need to understand what is the alt attribute. So there are a lot of things
Yeah.
within the content itself that you need to do to SEO optimize it. And once you have that post ready, publish it, and then you have to wait. So the waiting can be anything between 4 weeks to 3 months to 4 months, depending on the popularity of that search, depending on the Google algorithm itself, the number of times it crawls your site. So there are a lot of factors to it. So you don't know how long it's going to take you to index. But yeah, that's it's a waiting game. But Google is a lot. Google or SEO is a long-term game, but it has short benefits, which is why you need to invest early into it rather than late.
Right. Are there any free tools, SEO tools that you use along with your blog? I mean, one
there
I
are
know
lot.
yours.
Yeah, then there is UberSuggest, which is the Neil Patel's UberSuggest. So you
Okay.
can use that. That is also a free tool. But see, with the free tools, what happens is you have certain limitations that come in.
Yes.
So as you
Yes.
go deeper and deeper into blogging, it is better to invest into a paid tool. There are a lot of good paid tools actually. There is the one which I use is called as Key Search.
Key
So,
Search.
yeah, Key Search. So it's a paid tool. So I have invested into that, and then there are forget the name of the other tools. It's called Long Tail Keywords, longtailwords.com or something of that sort, which is again a paid tool. So there are a lot of available resources online which help you. They are not 100%, but they give you a good general direction. I don't think anyone can be 100% except Google. So that's a game that you have to anyway play. So yeah, Google itself has Google AdWords and stuff which give you a lot of keywords, and they're free of cost. But again, there is a limitation to it. So they only tell you what the content is, but they will not tell you the exact competition to it, or how many backlinks the competitor has, etc. So backlinks is another important aspect of SEO, because that also the backlinks is basically in a way a signal to Google saying how authoritative your site has been. So that
Right.
is also something that you need to just figure out, once you have published the post, how do you get good backlinks to it? Typically with good content, backlinks come very easily. Most of the time you don't have to look for it. But if you do have to
Yeah.
look for it, how do you look for it? Look, how do you evaluate it? Where do you figure out? I mean, that is a different kind of a science that you have to look at.
Okay, so in terms of an ideal length of your blog, I mean, some people write like 300 to 500 words blog. Some stretch it to more than 1,000. So as far as this SEO point is concerned, what is more favorable? Should you go for quantity, more number of blogs per week or per month, or look for lesser number of blogs per longer? I mean, 1,500 words or 2,000 words.
So this is where I feel the quality matters over quantity. Because Google also looks for expertise. They look for authority. So they rank sites which have, which either the author or the site per se has authority over that subject, right? So you need to have command over your content. You need to be expert in it. And that comes only with quality. So it typically 300, 400 words, as far as I know, Google doesn't really rank. It's
okay.
Minimum of 800 words, I think. At least that's what I recall last reading about. They say the longer the blog, the better it is. Long content always is favored better because It also shows authority. It gives unique content because Google is not looking for frivolous content. They are looking for
Right.
depth, basically. So typically, long posts signal depth in your content. So that also adds to your ranking factor. So yeah, quality over quantity in this case.
You need to really sit down, invest your time, write long articles. That ultimately helps. There are no like
There are
shortcuts
shortcuts.
to
So
300 words, 100 words.
you know, it doesn't work, which is why yesterday I mentioned saying typically a blog takes me over 1.5 months for 1.5 days to write. This is exactly the reason why, because when I collect the content, when I come back, I collect the content, there is keyword research that happens. Then after the keyword research, the writing happens, the editing happens, then you are adding the pictures. Pictures are edited, renamed properly and put on. And then you add the authority links, because in your post you need to have links. There's outbound links, inbound links, etc. So you add those links, and then finally you publish it. So it's 1.5 days.
Right.
So yeah.
Now I've like started the blog, and let's say my motive is to showcase what I experience, but on the same time I would want to earn. So what are the avenues of earning through your blog?
See, there are multiple. The first thing that most of us hit on is AdWords, Google Ads, basically. They pay you cost per, I mean, it's CPC model, which is cost per click kind of a thing. It's like a trickle, okay? So they pay you when you get about US$100, which takes anything between 6 months to 1 year or even more, right? But yeah, it does feel good to have that little trickle coming in. So typically, that is the first place most of us start earning. Then there is something called as sponsored posts. Now, to explain sponsored posts, it's like having an article on your blog. Your blog is basically a magazine or a printed medium, for example. So how does a printed medium earn? They earn through ads, which is your AdWords, and then they earn through sponsored content, which people place on in their publication, right? So it's the same thing in the blog. So there are people who will place content on your blog. So that's called sponsored posts. And the sponsored posts, basically, you start at a little low rate, but then you can work your way up, because as your website gets a certain reputation, you will start, getting the, you will start commanding a premium, basically. So there's that sponsored content, which gives you a certain amount of revenue. Then, as things get better, basically, as your traffic increases, you can get into affiliate marketing. You tie up with related industries, for example, hotels or maybe airlines or any tour companies. And you basically get a percentage of their sale, which is made through your website. So that is basically affiliate marketing. So there is something called as affiliate marketing, which basically you can earn through. So largely, yeah, these are the three avenues. As your traffic increases, what also happens is there are media companies which will approach you, and you will start earning on cost per impression, which is basically every time the ad flashes, you get some amount. It's again some point X dollars, but you accumulate that much faster than you would accumulate with a Google ads AdWords, sorry, ads and spend for scenario. Because over there, it is every time only when that guy clicks, you get some money. Here, every time the ad flashes, you get the money. So as your traffic increases, the number of ads also increase on your website, which means you will earn more. So that model, you can actually shift to that model as your traffic basically gets better. And there are a lot of companies like MediaWine and eZoic, which offer you this model. I think eZoic is about 15,000 sessions in a month. You should be able to get 15,000 sessions in a month. And I think in case of MediaWine, it is around 30,000.
That's a minimum that you should be having on your website.
Minimum you should have in a month, yes.
Okay. Should we just look at the questions, I guess, once?
Thanks, Tanayesh, and setback upright. You totally made my day. Hi, Ruthvi. I can see. Hi, everyone, actually. It's kind of difficult to keep up, but. I think I lost the earlier questions, so maybe.
So I have one from Shepherd Traveler. Ma'am, what type of content we should write and promote right now due to corona pandemic?
See, travel has been on a low. My own website has been hit for quite some time. But the what I realized is a lot of people like to do virtual travels, which is basically descriptive posts about places that you've been to, so that they can relive an experience or actually plan something for themselves. So it's almost like giving them a virtual tour while they're sitting at home. So those kind of posts seem to be working pretty well. Nobody wants to see a travel guide at this point in time because it's, I mean, in the
Can't
foreseeable
travel.
future, yeah,
Yeah.
foreseeable future, I don't think a lot of us are going to be able to travel out. So armchair travel really works well. In that also, culture, heritage, kind of destinations is what I think people like reading because it also is a little knowledgeable, gives them a little story and stuff. So yes, I think those are the posts which are working right now. I wouldn't say the traffic is completely zero. People are still looking, but it definitely has hit. It's been hit quite a bit.
So for all the travelers who want to make their career in travel and associated profession to that, I mean, so if I'm a freelance traveler and I want to earn money related to my experiences, so there can be my blog, can be, I should be
freelance
making either
writing.
videos, writing, or clicking good photos. So How do you decide, I mean, which one you should be opting for?
Honestly, that's your passion and skill sets. What I've also realized is that as you keep doing things, you evolve. So I look at my own self, I see how I was writing earlier and to what I'm writing now. There's a certain evolving that has happened over time, and that is expected. Along the way, you will, you know, also figure out that, for example, photography, when I started off, there were a lot of errors I made. I wouldn't know how to do, I didn't know how to do Lightroom, basic edits and stuff. But over time, I realized that, you know, this is a skill that I want to learn better. So I got into it furthermore. So now it's like a combination of the two. And photography is a has been a passion, so it was easy. But then for some people, photography doesn't matter. They like video.
Yep.
I know a lot of good travel bloggers who are big time into videos. But you know, for me, I don't like editing and all so much in terms of videos. I mean, it takes a lot of my time. It's either writing
Yeah.
or editing. I can't
Yeah.
do both. So I stuck to writing. There are people who go into editing. They don't mind doing a lot of editing. So they have chosen that. So there is no particular thing that I would say works for everyone. It's purely your passion. It's purely what you like doing. A lot of people don't like writing so much. So they prefer looking at other avenues like photo blog. That's also not a bad deal. I mean, it's completely your passion. In terms of what pays more, it's a very difficult question, to be honest. I think right now video definitely works. Followed
Yeah.
by writing. I'm not very sure about the photo blogs. I think photo blogs comes more with freelance photography and photography projects. I'm really not sure how photo blogs as such work. It's more like a showcase, to be honest.
Right. We have another question from Just Cramming. How many blogs we should upload per week?
There is no set number, but it is important to keep your blog roll ticking. So basically, if you've decided you're going to do one blog in a week, make sure you continue doing that you have one blog in a week. Once in a while, here and there, it's fine if you've not been able to do it. But if your minimum frequency is one blog a week, make sure it is there one blog a week. The more you write, the better it is, because Google is always looking for fresh content. But one thing I have realized is it's impossible to continuously write, because writing definitely needs a breather. Otherwise, you tend to get monotonous. So whatever frequency works for you, that is great. There is absolutely no issue, even if you do one per week or if you do 7 in a week. But 7 in a week, that's what likely will burn out. So either you'll run out of content or you'll burn out writing, one of the two. It doesn't matter even if you do one a week.
I'll just see if we have more questions. I don't think we have more questions on this. Guys, if you have any further questions about travel blogging, you can either DM Amy or me. We have few more sessions lined up with Amy, so we can always take up the questions in next sessions. Quite an insightful session, Amy. I guess I would get some motivation to start my stuff rolling. Deciding upon a theme has been the biggest challenge for me. I have shuffled so many times with my theme. I mean, it's so difficult to visualize actually how it should look, where to place what element, what all heading should I be writing. It has been
So,
a task.
yeah, but honestly speaking, one of the things that I took into account when I was planning a theme is that you need to keep in mind how easy you can make it for your audience. When a reader comes, they shouldn't be struggling too much between where to go. And at the same time, you should not overwhelm them. If you put like too many, gadgety things or flashy things on your blog, they get overwhelmed. They're like, "अरे ये कहाँ से शुरू करूँ" kind of a thing.
Something
They
coming
start
from here,
complaining.
something coming from here.
Yeah. My advice is think like how you would be a reader, and then design your blog accordingly. And also, don't keep changing your theme, because your theme also alters your back end, which also affects your SEO in a lot of ways. So if you are sticking to a theme, make sure you stick to it for a while at least, and then probably shift if you have to shift, kind of a thing.
Yeah, people, please go out and check her blog. It has got a beautiful theme and a beautiful message that pops up first time you go
I had
currently.
to write it at that point in time because I didn't want people
It's
to. Yeah, no, it's important, because right now, I mean, at least a couple of weeks back when I had put it, people were just going crazy trying to travel domestically, and we hadn't gone into a complete lockdown. So I said, no, it's important that when somebody comes to my blog, and because I've been putting new blogs, it's not like I've stopped writing. I'm still writing. They shouldn't think that I'm encouraging travel, because I'm at this point in time telling you people, stay safe, stay home. It's pretty important. Let's just tide over this entire mess. I'll be the first one to travel, to be honest, the moment it is opened up. But for
We'll all
now,
wait
I think,
for
yeah. For now, I think it was important, and that is why that pop-up on my blog saying, "Please stay at
that
home
was
for some
really nice.
time."
I mean, very few. I don't remember exactly any other blog that is showing up that message currently. So it was amazing, frankly.
Thank you.
So thrillingtravel.in. Please go out and check for this surprise. It's a beautiful message over there. We have another session planned up with Amy tomorrow, and that is centric of around women travelers. So we'll be talking about women travelers. Amy would be sharing her experiences, do's and don'ts, how to make your life easier as a women traveler. And yeah, hope to see all of you joining again, same time, same place. Thank you
Same
so much,
handle.
Amy.
You should say
Same
same handle.
handle, yeah, same handles. So yeah, Thanks so much, Sammy. Thanks everyone for joining in. We
Thank
will
you,
see you
everyone.
tomorrow at 5.
See you,
See you.
bye. See you, Pankaj. Bye.
Bye-bye.